Do you remember the days that you could buy new, a capable of playing modern AAA titles, low-tier graphics cards for $150 and not traded with human organs? Since these days have gone and human organs are best kept intact inside the human body, I searched the Swedish market for you and bought this beautiful, used MSI GTX 1050 Ti Gaming X GPU that was available for a reasonable price. The question is, can it play games with decent performance in 2022, or is it a total waste of money? Let's find it out. Launched in 2016, Nvidia's GTX 1050 and 1050 Ti targeted the low-budget graphics card market at a time when we were also experiencing an ongoing GPU shortage and price gouging. Our story's hero, the MSI GTX 1050 Ti Gaming X, appeared here today, ready to prove its worth as a possible remedy to this everlasting madness. Despite its 5 years old hardware, at least on paper, the MSI GTX 1050 Ti Gaming X has some very respectable specs. The 40nm GP107400A1 variant processor is based on Pascal architecture. It has 768 NVIDIA CUDA cores, a base clock of 1354MHz and a boost clock of 1468MHz, 4GB of GDDR5 RAM, 128-bit memory interface, running up to 1752MHz. It consumes on average 75W and it is using a 6-pin PCI Express power header to ensure the extra power boost in case of an overclocking attempt. Unlike some recent GPU implementations from AMD, the GTX 1050 Ti supports PCI Express 3.0, 16 lanes bus, it's capable for hardware encoding, it has 4 display outputs and of course it can run all the recent gaming titles based on all the newest DirectX, Vulkan and OpenGL APIs. The card measures 145mm in length, 111mm in width and features a dual slot cooling solution. It was introduced in Swedish market on October of 2016 at the price of $210 and it is still today one of the preferred cards among PC builders who convert old office computers into gaming PCs due to its small size and low power consumption. On paper, MSI GTX 1050 Ti Gaming X offers some solid specs for a low-tier graphics card. But how does this actually translate to gameplay performance? To answer that, I will run some tests. My benchmark PC was based upon the MSI B450M Mortar motherboard, accompanied by the AMD Ryzen 7 17000, overclocked at 3.7 GHz to mitigate as much as possible any CPU bottleneck. The 32GB of 3200MHz DDR4 memory will be plenty for the task. A 650W power supply unit can provide more than enough power for our components, and the 1TB Western Digital Blue NVMe M.2 drive will host the Windows 10 version 21H2 and all the software and games necessary to complete the tests. The graphics card is connected with a 27-inch 1080 max resolution and a 60Hz refresh rate display monitor. The graphics card will be running with the latest NVIDIA drivers. Since I'm still experimenting with my benchmarking process, I will use just one synthetic benchmark along with several different gaming titles. My long-term goal is to create a list of software that will fulfill few crucial requirements. The requirement of running the same test multiple times and get reasonably similar results is the most crucial one. The easiest way to accomplish this is to conduct synthetic benchmarks, of which I find 3DMark should to be the most appropriate. Unfortunately, synthetic benchmarks have the disadvantage that their results are comparable only within the benchmarking environment itself. They do not reveal much about the actual performance of a computer under gaming conditions. Therefore, the PC games I will run will have built-in benchmarks. Those will be Hitman 3, The Division 2, Total War Saga Troy, and the free demos of Forza Horizon 4 and Shadow of Tomb Raider. The standard goal for all the games will be to run at 1080 resolution and average 30 frames per second, which is the performance level typically targeted by video game consoles and low-budget gaming PCs. The exception to the above rule are games that you need higher frame bracket, for example first-person shooters, or other fast-paced games that you need higher responsiveness. In this case, the average of 60 frames per second will be the absolute minimum. To ensure that no other procedure interferes with the testing results, I use a second computer and an old external USB device made by Elgato to capture and record the gameplay footage. The final video output is the result of 1080 30 frames per second MP4 file. The graphics card is said to feed the Elgato device with maximum frames per second, while the Elgato card is capable of capturing only 30 frames per second. This is the reason why you may experience some video tearing occasionally, and it has nothing to do with the graphics card actual performance. Finally, it is very important the people that they are watching right now this video to understand what all these numbers at the upper left corner of the captured gameplay screen mean. So, beginning from the first table row, we're looking at the stats of the graphics card. The first column is the model name, the second column the GPU utilization, meaning how hard the graphics processor unit works. Then we have the frequency of the GPU in megahertz, indicating how fast the GPU works. Third column shows the temperature. In the fourth column, we see how hard the fans of the graphics card are spinning. And in the last column, we have the approximate watt the card is consuming. In the second row, we have the stats of the graphics card video memory, with the first number indicating the memory usage in gigabytes and the second number showing the frequency of the memory. The higher the frequency of the GPU and memory, the better the performance. The higher the GPU utilization, the higher the GPU temperature, resulting in higher fan speeds and therefore louder noise levels. The same rules apply to the CPU stats at the third row. Once again, we have the model name, the CPU utilization, the CPU frequency, the CPU temperature, and in the last column, the CPU's watt consumption. In the fourth row, we have the system memory and how much gigabytes of RAM we use to run the game. Under the RAM row, there is the frames per second, meaning how many distinct still images the computer can output in 1 second. The higher the number of the frames, the smoother the video game will run. In the sixth row, there is the average number of the frames per second we got the given period of time we run the test. The more time we run a test, the more accurate the average number will be. This is also true for the next row that showcases the 1% law of the frames per second. Basically, what this means is that if you line up all the frame rates from the highest to lowest, you pick the worst 100 values and then you find their mean number, aka the average number of the 1% law. Easy, right? And with this display of math prowess, it is time for our hero to enter the benchmarking arena, prove his worth, and entertaining the masses. First, our hero will confront the 3DMark Firestrike, a synthetic benchmark that makes use of a variety of DirectX 11 features and processing effects. The demo version let me run the test only at 1080 with the rest of the features locked. It contains two graphics tests for the GPU, a physics test for the CPU, and a combined test for both. At the end, we get a detailed report with nice graphs. Our MSI GTX 1050 Ti Gaming X gives a graphics score of 8144 and a total 7360 points. The frame rate never dropped below 30. Both GPU and CPU worked at 100%, but both kept low temperatures. Impressive if you think that 3DMark Firestrike isn't a lightweight benchmark. As mentioned before, the above results are comparable only within the benchmarking environment itself, and they don't correlate apples to apples with actual gaming performance. To solve this problem, I'm going to use PC games with integrated benchmarks. Beginning with the title of 2021, Hitman 3 is a visually impressive but also resource-intensive game. Moreover, Hitman's integrated benchmark reflects accurate the in-game performance. With only API to choose DirectX 12, VSync off at 1080 resolution and ultra settings, the MSI GTX 1050 Ti Gaming X produces average 40fps and 30fps 1% low with a bit of jumpy medium levels frame time. The video memory almost tops at 3.7GB and the system memory at 7.5GB. The GPU works at 100% while the CPU goes max 60% utilization, indicating of course that the graphics card is the bottlenecking hardware here. Almost the same performance, we're looking at high settings with average 3 more frames per second and a little bit less memory utilization. On medium settings, we succeed to get 100% low 30fps, but below 50 average FPS. Still, this is 20% better performance than ultra settings. Finally, at low settings, we reach the 61 frames per second average and almost 50 frames per second 1% low, perfect for our 1080p 60Hz monitor. Moreover, even when Hitman 3 stressed out the graphics card, the temperatures never exceeded the 65 degrees Celsius, suggesting that there is plenty of room for overclocking. Leaving the world of assassinations and jumping into the real-time strategy with Total War Saga Troy, containing also a great built-in benchmark. with an exclusive DirectX 11 engine VSync off at 1080 and Ultra settings, we get a gaming console frame rate experience with 36 average FPS and 29 FPS for the 1% low. The frame time fluctuates between 25 to 30 milliseconds, only half of the video memory is occupied, with the system memory reaching the 7.7 GB. The GPU works at 100% while the CPU is chilling at mid-30s most of the time. At high settings, we get 33% more performance with average 48 and 1% low 41 frames per second. And on medium settings, we have average 74 and 1% low 62 frames per second, reaching our desired target for a smooth gameplay. Choosing between the different preset quality modes, Total War Saga Troy offers a scalable performance, and the MSI 1050 Ti Gaming X will have no problem to run smoothly this game. Taking a look at gaming title from 2018, Shadow of Tomb Raider, contains a well-known built-in benchmark, which even today is often used by tech YouTubers and PC gamers. This game offers the choice between DirectX 12 and DirectX 11. I began with the former, at highest settings and always VSync off at 1080 resolution. No surprises here, Shadow of Tomb Raider is a very demanding game, and the GTX 1050 Ti gave average 35 and minimum 27 frames per second. So I jumped into high settings and the overall performance was almost the same, with an average of 41 and minimum 31 frames per second, which is absolutely fine if you want to have the game console experience. But since I use a computer, I tried for the desirable minimum 60 frames per second, and even at lowest settings that was impossible, getting average 68 and minimum 53 frames per second. Changing into DirectX 11 resulted in worse frame times and lower minimum frame rates than DirectX 12. Sadly, MSI 1050 Ti Gaming X came close to the finish line, but no bueno hermano. The low GPU temperatures indicated that an overclock might offer the desirable frames per second, but this is not the scope of this video, that's why we move on into the next race. The Forza Horizon 4, running only in DirectX 12, a visually beautiful integrated benchmark back from 2019. At ultra settings, 1080, the MSI 1050 Ti achieved 58 average and 49 minimum frames per second respectively, outperforming the game console frame rate standard. Temperatures as always low, and a flat line frame time graph is a good omen for the following test at high settings, resulting in the desirable minimum 60 and average 76 frames per second, giving the green light to the MSI 1050 Ti to proceed into the final boss. The Division 2. An open-world third-person shooter that has a demanding built-in benchmark, which replicates pretty good the actual in-game performance. Selecting DirectX 12 1080 VSync off Ultra settings, the graphics card couldn't exceed the average 30 frames per second. With a bumpy frame time graph, the video RAM at max levels, and the system RAM fluctuating between 11 to 12 GB, resembling the Tomb Raider situation, possibly pointing out that the graphics card is out of memory, causing it to use the slower system memory as an extra tank, resulting in poor performance. And indeed, dropping the settings too high, we had average 40 and 1% low 32 frames per second, with max VRAM usage 3.5 GB and system RAM 10 GB. For a game like The Division 2, these levels of frames per second are absolutely acceptable, though marginally close to the minimum. Medium settings gave a little boost, but not the desirable 60 frames per second. Switching to DirectX 11 didn't help at all. I had to drop the settings to low to surprisingly watch the frames per second jumping at 93 and 76 frames per second average and 1% low respectively, a 76% difference from the previous 53 average and 54 1% low frames per second, showcasing that there is plenty of headroom to tweak the graphics configuration and find a better combination of high, medium and low quality settings. Before I move to the conclusions, I would like to mention NVIDIA's image scaling and sharpening implementation, which can provide the extra frames we need while compromising the image quality depending on the scaling level we choose. All I had to do was to enable this function through NVIDIA's control panel, choose a lower resolution and play with the sharpening level until I hit the desirable frames per second. Running again the integrated benchmark of Shadow of Tomb Raider at lowest settings, but this time scaling at 720 resolution and sharpening level 20%, the GTX 1050 Ti gave average 93 and minimum 81 frames per second. Comparing that with the previous average 68 and minimum 53 frames per second at native 1080 lowest settings, I got an amazing 44% higher performance with minimal drop on image quality. I believe image scaling sharpening implementation techniques offer a better way to maximize maximize the performance of a used, out-of-warranty graphics card than the riskier overclocking solution. There is, of course, the downside of the lower graphics quality, but at this period of time, with the current GPU market, this is a very small toll to pay. My final thoughts about the MSI GTX 1050 Ti are very positive. We have a low-tier graphics card back from 2016 that still can run decently modern AAA titles at 1080, middle to low settings with some compromises. The red-black shroud that hosts the twin Frozer cooling system is capable to keep the card cool and silent, even under the most demanding situations. Most of the times the fan's utilization was between 0 and 25%. I'm trying to remember the times that the temperature reached the 70 degrees Celsius. I cannot deny the fact that we are at the end of the cheap PC gaming era. With the old 4-core 8-threads CPUs and 4GB VRAM graphics cards steadily and quickly becoming the new obsolete hardware. More and more gaming titles implement technologies that require at least 6GB of video memory and utilize at least 4 CPU cores to run effectively. Sadly, this change comes at the worst possible period of time, while greedy companies and greedy people are making outrageous profits, taking advantage of people who want to escape for a few moments from the harsh or mundane reality, entering the digital world of the video games with their friends and have some genuine fun. I believe the MSI GTX 1050 Ti Gaming X, being found at a good condition and reasonable price, definitely has a place at any low-budget game PC, acting as a true aid for someone who wants to purchase a graphics card and play games in 2022 at low-medium quality, 1080 resolution, and 30 to 60 frames per second without spending a fortune. You also won't need to spend anything if you decide to subscribe to this channel. Moreover, if you found the theme of this video interesting, then be sure to check out the video where I talk about how you can turn an office computer into a gaming PC. Until we meet again, take care, farewell, goodbye, I leave you with a smile.